with an invocation by Pastor Kevin Hankey. While the pastor is coming forward, I'll indicate that his pronunciation used to be German, and he said it was honky at one time, but now it's Hankey. So, Pastor, welcome.
Thank you.
Supervisors and audience, please all stand.
In the name of the Father who loved us, the Son who taught and bought us, and the Spirit who feeds and leads us. Dear God, Heavenly Father, sometimes it is so easy to look at the future and to see nothing but problems and things to worry about. Help us instead to look at the future with gratitude and with hope of all the many blessings you continue to give us. It is so easy to see the good things and then take them for granted, or as if we are expected or owed them. And teach us rather to look at the good things and give thanks, and even the bad things, help us to see the good that might be lying underneath them and the blessings that you might be sending us. Help us also to remember that we are servants of your people, and we are not here to serve ourselves. Help us to do our work with diligence, with gratitude, and with honor to your people and your name. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Supervisors, please indicate your attendance to establish a quorum. We have 17 supervisors present, and a quorum has been established. And with that, I will call on our administrator, Pat Thompson, for his report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to wish everybody a happy new year. Look forward to working with the board and a changing board come April of 2012. Some of the areas that we'll be focusing on in the next few months as we enter into 2012, we'll continue to monitor the 2012 budget and the finances of the county. We will monitor the state budget and the impact on St. Croix County as that budget and the recommendations that come forward from it will, in some areas of our operation, have an impact. We will continue to monitor that. If changes or amendments need to be addressed during the course of the year, we'll bring those before the administration committee and the county board for consideration. But at this point, our 2012 budget at this point does not need to be addressed in terms of any changes based on what's coming out of Madison. Another area that we'll be continue to focus on is labor management relations between the county and those employees represented with collective bargaining agreements through 2012. I'll continue to meet with the leadership of the unions to continue the dialogue necessary to provide good, strong labor management relations as we work our way through that the last year of collective bargaining agreement. We also have the phase two pay study, which is currently in process, and that is with the SCOPE employees, the St. Croix County office and professional employees group scope. That study of those positions is currently underway. We'll be working through the recommendations that come forward from that, presenting those to the administration committee and the full county board. Another area of focus will be the finalization of the county's strategic plan, which I began working on shortly after my arrival last June. And we presented preliminary work to the Committee of the Whole on the strategic plan 3 months ago, 3-4 months ago. We will provide an update to the Committee of the Whole at our next meeting in January as a final strategic plan. It will be brought to the Committee of the Whole and then to the full county board for approval. A component of the strategic plan, another focus of 2012, will be the development of a pay-for-performance system, which will entail quite a bit of work, but we've already started that process, and hopefully by mid-year 2012 we'll have a system in place for evaluations of all employees, and compensation decisions based will be based on performance. But the system needs to be in place before we implement that, and it needs to be approved by the County Board of Supervisors, which will be done hopefully by mid-year. Along with that, I will be beginning a process of evaluations for all management employees, those department heads that currently report to me. We will be going through in the next several months a series of performance evaluations, and although we don't have the compensation piece finalized yet, the evaluations that take place in the next few months will play into the pay-for-performance system, which will hopefully be implemented by mid-year. I will continue to monitor all staffing levels in all departments, and as vacancies occur, we have taken a very keen eye, a very strategic focus on all vacancies. We will continue to do that. Where possible, we will restructure, reorganize, realign, you name it, to try to at least, I don't want to say eliminate staff, but we want to make sure that when a decision is made to fill a position that has become vacant, that it's based on a true need, and not just automatically filling positions as they become vacant and just filling them. We need to look very closely at the organization, how we're structured. Can positions be realigned? Do duties need to be reassigned? That we will continue to do that throughout the course of the year. And hopefully that reduce county expenditures by reducing staffing costs. It's something we will continue to do. In April, we'll have new board supervisors. I would like to work with the county board on developing an orientation of some sort for the new county board supervisors that will be coming in, taking office in April of this year. I think staff will provide whatever input and whatever assistance we can to help orientate new board supervisors in 2012. I think it's important, and I will lend whatever support is necessary to make sure that that is successful. This afternoon I'll be meeting with school district officials from the Hudson School District, and we will be talking about their need for future space for county or school facilities. This was an issue that came up at our December Administration Committee meeting to formally extend an invitation to enter into a dialogue with the school district regarding their needs for space, land, for future school purposes. So I will be meeting formally with several school district officials this afternoon to just have a dialogue. And whatever information that is shared in that meeting, I will report back to the administration committee at our next meeting. I think the chairman will be talking about during the announcements that we're in the process of scheduling a committee of the whole meeting in January. And the administration committee is meeting immediately following this meeting to begin the development of an agenda for that meeting in January. But one agenda item for sure will be the presentation of the final strategic plan in January. That's one agenda item that I will be recommending. That is it for my report, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Pat.
There's a question.
Supervisor yes. Malik.
Administrator Thompson, is it the case that the land surrounding this building in Hudson is all currently zoned for public use only?
That's correct.
And that is a reason that the administration committee asked you to enter into discussions with the school district, which is probably one of the two potential users of this property other than the county, namely the city or the school district. Thank you, Mr.
Yeah.
Chairman.
Supervisors, the agenda has been distributed for your prior review. It would be my intention to walk through the agenda in the order that's presented, probably someplace in there, depending on where we're at that particular time, along about 10 o'clock or a little bit after. We'll probably take a short break, get some coffee and refreshment, but if there is no objection, will proceed in the order that's here. The consent agenda is also distributed. We have the minutes of the previous session and the announcement of the date of the next meeting. Is there a motion on the consent agenda? We have a motion from Supervisor Schrank and a second from Supervisor Larson. Roger, if you put your second in, please. We have a motion from Supervisor Schrank, second from Supervisor Larson to approve the consent agenda. Proceed to vote. And the consent agenda is approved unanimously. We have no appointments to announce this morning. There will be some appointments. I discussed this morning with Casey Swetlick. There will be some appointments at our next board meeting to the LEPC committee. We have no outside presentations this morning, so we'll proceed with our business. But I would jump down and at this point call your attention to the committee reports. And we will take those first. We do have annual reports from our county treasurer and from our county clerk. Supervisors, these have been distributed for your review. I'll direct your attention, first of all, to the annual report from county treasurer, Lori Noble. I urge you to retain the annual reports for reference. But at this point, are there any questions or comments that you wish to direct to Lori? Supervisor Malik.
Is this report available electronically also? I didn't get it in advance of the meeting, so I'm not in a position to make any comment on it, but...
Lori, why don't you come forward and respond to the question?
Yes, I can go ahead and send you an electronic of that. Finishing up the year end, I just want to make sure I was accurate on reporting figures, so that's why I present it to you today. But I can go ahead and send you an electronic version also, if you like.
Can you upload it to our website also, so the public can see it?
Sure, we can do that.
Thank you.
Supervisor Hermsen.
Thank you, Board Chair. Lori, I see we've got quite a trend going yet. Doesn't seem to be backing off on the number of delinquencies or the number of tax deeds parcels. Is there, have you guys, can you give the board any insight as to how we're going to tackle this and get it straightened out? It's, boy, for 2011, that's almost up 100%.
Yes, well, we're doing whatever we can, basically. We're setting up payments. People have been coming in and making payments, structured payments. We kind of follow those. We make cold calls. We're doing whatever we can to bring payments in to keep people current and out of that tax deed process.
Do you feel like we're making headway on it, or, I mean...
Well, last year, I mean, to begin the year last year, we had over 600 parcels in tax deeding. And as you can see on my last page, how many parcels we're actually going to be taking through the tax deed process. Out of 600 and some, those are the ones that we are currently looking at to actually take. We have Town of Emerald, a lot there. We have City of New Richmond, a commercial lot, which is abandoned. City of New Richmond, we have 15 lots. It's basically vacant lots there. And then Village of Woodville, we have 24 lots. In Town of Springfield, there's a half-acre lot. So considering that we started out with over 600 parcels, that basically that's what we're looking at currently.
Any other questions for Lori?
I just wanted to make another comment as far as my budget for tax deed, which was set at $4,000. Our expenses exceeded that. It was approximately $4,700, but we did recoup in reimbursements about $1,135 in reimbursements from people that we had to send out notices to and serve them notices and whatnot. So we did make an effort to recoup those costs. So, again, our budget did exceed that, but with reimbursements, it brought us back into alignment to where we should be. So we're making all efforts to watch and track those costs, as well as try to keep those parcels out of the actual tax deed where we take the parcels. Are there any other questions? Or?
Thank you, Larry. Then I would direct your attention, supervisors, to the annual report from County Clerk Cindy Campbell. That has also been provided for you. Any questions or comments with respect to the report from County Clerk Campbell? And it looks like you get a pass. Thank you very much. Well, spoke too soon. Supervisor Malik.
That's right. Can't hold a lawyer down. Good news is usually welcome. And since you didn't point it out, Mr. Chairman, I will, that this report, by including on the second page the expenditures of the county board committees and commissions, illustrates that apparently the county board itself and its committees is coming in under budget significantly, suggesting that efforts to eliminate unnecessary meetings and things resulting perhaps from a 19-member board instead of a 31-member board is actually saving the taxpayers money.
Thank you, Supervisor. I appreciate you saying that. I couldn't have said it better. Any additional comments or observations with respect to the report from the county clerk? Supervisor Marzoff.
This will be the last time I'll be here for Cindy's report, annual report, and I just want to say to you, Cindy, and to your staff over the years that I've had the privilege of working with you. Your office has gone way overboard and done an outstanding job to serve the public as your mission statement indicates. Thank you.
Here, here.
Thank you, Supervisor Marza. Supervisor Urmson.
Thank you, Board Chair. Cindy, does your budget for this year, given the recalls that are that we're seeing, is that reflected in your budget?
Any potential recalls were not included
yes,
in the 2012 budget. We're not. I budgeted for four elections.
So in the event that there is this recall, any idea what kind of a fiscal impact that would have on your budget?
This year's, well, just going by this year's recalls, they were about 32,000 for the primary and the general, July and August.
Seeing no other comments, thank you very much, Cindy. Supervisors, we are ready to begin our normal agenda items. Agenda item number one is a resolution authorizing St. Croix County's participation in the Wisconsin Economic Development Block Grant Program for Fiber Star, Inc. This comes from the Administration Committee. Chair would entertain a motion. Motion from Supervisor Sicard, second from Supervisor Wentz. In the event that any discussion is necessary on this or any questions, Char Gurney is present this morning for any questions. Supervisors, are there any questions with respect to this resolution? We have participated in the block grant program over the years successfully. Any questions with regard to this specific block grant for FiberStar Inc.? Seeing none, I believe we're ready to vote. Supervisor Wentz, do you have your second in place?
I have it in place.
Proceed to vote on the resolution authorizing our participation in the Wisconsin Economic Development Block Grant Program for FiberStar Inc. And that is approved unanimously. Agenda item number two is a resolution to issue a quitclaim deed to William and Teresa DeYoung. This resolution comes to us from the Administration Committee. Chair would entertain a motion. Motion from Supervisor Norton Bauman and a second from Supervisor Larson. Discussion. Seeing none, I assume that means that you are fully versed on this. Supervisor Larson, do you have your second in place?
Yes.
Supervisors, proceed to vote. This is a resolution to issue a quitclaim deed to William and Teresa DeYoung. This is approved unanimously. Agenda item number three is a resolution approving receipt of established rate of compensation by Sheriff's Deputy Tamara Mark, and this comes from the Public Protection Committee. Chair would entertain a motion from Supervisor Larson and a second from Supervisor Malik. Sheriff Schultz is present in the event that there are any specific questions that need to be addressed. Discussion. We have handled these in the past somewhat routinely. Seeing no hands, I assume that you are prepared to vote. Supervisor Malik's second is in place. Supervisors, proceed to vote on the resolution approving receipt of established rate of pay of compensation by Sheriff's Deputy Tamara Mark. And that is approved unanimously. Agenda item number 4 is an ordinance repealing a previous ordinance. You can see the specific reference to dates and years, and creating Chapter 63, which is a maintenance and board of jail inmates of the St. Croix County Code of Ordinances. This ordinance is forwarded us by the Public Protection Committee, and Chair would entertain a motion from Supervisor Larson with a second from Supervisor Schrenk. Discussion. Supervisor Marzoff.
I might be overlooking it, Mr. Chair, but I'm sorry, I see it now. I was looking for the therefore be it resolved, and it's there, but it's in different words. Thank you.
Supervisor Lucky.
On the first page of this, I am looking at this 6301B. It says, for each inmate, the sheriff or his or her designee shall choose whether to seek reimbursement under this chapter. And I wondered, are we going to get into any sort of legal situation alleging that we're not treating everyone equally?
No, the statute says exactly that language, that the sheriff has that choice to make that choice.
Okay, well then, when you get down to 6302, all of these next ones, A, B, C, D, and E on the next page, say, use the verb either will be charged or shall be, and I wonder, should all of those read may be charged?
Supervisor Lucky, I'm going to ask the sheriff to come forward and respond to these. This resolution, this ordinance actually is probably best addressed by John.
Good morning. A couple of good questions, Supervisor Lucky. I think on the first point, the reason that verbiage is in there is sometimes we will get students who are serving, and we opt not to charge them the fee because, quite frankly, they don't have an income, but we like to see them get their education and try and maintain good citizenship. So that's why that particular provision is in there. As to the second question, that may be better answered by Don Gillen. I don't necessarily have an issue with the particular verbiage, since we have the ability for me to decide if, in fact, we will charge the fees based on the inmate's ability to pay or their situation in life.
Yeah, if the first part you're going to get to pick and choose, then in the second part it seems like you should indicate that also by saying may be charged.
I agree. I think that's correct. I think that makes sense.
Okay, well then I will move to change in A to change will be to may be, In B, to charge will be to maybe. In C, to change shall be to maybe. In C1, change will be to maybe. 2, will be to maybe. 3, will be to maybe. 4, shall be to maybe. D, shall be to maybe. And on the next page, E1, shall be to maybe. What?
E2 already has maybe.
No, I said E1.
Oh, yeah, I know you did. But ironically, your point is reflected in E2.
Yes.
Supervisor Lucky, you're offering that as an amendment?
Yes.
Is there a second to the amendment? Second from Supervisor Malik. Discussion on the amendment. Supervisor Hermsen.
Thank you, Board Chair. You know, I really struggle with this whole resolution in and of itself, but the wording has just changed. Now would appear to who makes the decision as far as the will be or shall be portion. If we're saying we're going to leave that up to the sheriff, are we in fact now making the sheriff a second judge of the prisoner? I'm very uncomfortable with that position. I'm going to leave it at that, just to kind of take that into mind. Who gets to decide when it's a shall or a would be or will be? No. What was the word you changed to?
Maybe.
Maybe. That's thank you. A maybe. Who decides yes or no to that?
I'll ask the sheriff to respond.
Also a good point. The may portion, when the ordinance was originally authored, was meant for me to allow me to use discretion where it came to Huber fees. The other fees should be charged to the inmates, in my opinion. If they are indigent, there are certain things that they can get free of charge. We will provide them with all the necessities that they need to have good health care and things while they're in our facilities. However, some of these other charges, I agree with Supervisor Hermsen, should be charged to all.
Is that responsive to your question, Supervisor Hermsen?
Yes.
Supervisor Norton-Bauman?
Thank you, Board Chair. Perhaps to clean up this language in 63.01B, perhaps the language should say that for each inmate, the sheriff or his or her designee may choose rather than shall. And then the language which Supervisor Lucky has asked to be changed from will to may could be left with the word will, because that would, at least the way I'm figuring it out here, if we change B and change the word shall to may, that would give the sheriff the opportunity to decide that he may decide whether to seek reimbursement. But if he does decide to seek reimbursement, everything in 63.02 could say will be charged. Did I make myself clear?
Well, first of all, I'm asking, are you offering this as an amendment to the amendment?
Well, I just like to...
At the moment, it's discussion.
Yeah, it's
Supervisor Lucky.
I think that still makes it inconsistent. And I did miss one.
I think it still makes it inconsistent if we did what Sharon said. And second of all, I missed one. So I'd like to add to my motion that if we're going to do this, that if... on the second page should be changed to maybe. But I think if you're saying that at the top that he's going to choose, then the second part should be may, not will be. Confuses people. Are we or aren't we?
Chair inquires of the sheriff with respect to the amendment question that's in front of us. Should the amendment prevail from your department, are you okay with that change?
I don't have any issue with the change. I'll operate as I would have under the ordinance that was originally presented. State statute does give me the ability to decide whether or not to charge, so it is in line with statutes.
Okay. Additional discussion on the amendment. Supervisor Sather.
My only comment is I'm fully confident that the staff will get reimbursement wherever and whenever possible. And I think that common sense says this is, if they can, they will. But there's no sense in forcing them to spin their wheels, wasting time and money, going after people that can't or won't pay anyway. I think he'll get one. I'm confident, again, that staff is going to get as much reimbursement as they can, and this just allows them to do it and make some common sense decisions.
So, Supervisor Sather, you are speaking in favor of the amendment.
Yes. Even without the amendment, I'm sure they would have gone after as much as they can anyway. But I'm happy with the amendment. It just reads better.
Additional discussion on the amendment. Supervisor Hermsen.
Thank you, Board Chair. I just want the board to maybe think along this line. If we're going to put this in here in a May fashion, giving the sheriff the ability to decide, goes to Supervisor Sather's point in that, remember, we're trying to recoup funds of dollars that we really decide from a levy standpoint. If the sheriff doesn't get it, it's coming out of our budget regardless. Now, the whole reason this came forward, and as I recall, I raised the question in public protection when this was first brought out, was because it needs an ordinance in order for the sheriff to have this ability to do what he's asking here, to be the arbiter of deciding who pays and who doesn't. And given that it's our budget, really it's our decision, we were granting him the authority to go after these dollars. I had requested that really that this should have gone, since it needed an ordinance, that it should have went to a public hearing, because it really is an agreement between us and the people as to how we're going to charge someone in the event that they are imprisoned. So I would speak against the amendment of changing to May and leave it back here to this board whether we're going to. Well, I think we need to give the sheriff specific direction and not leave him to be the decider at that point, because just like Supervisor Sather said, he's going to get his money regardless.
Supervisor Lucky.
Well, Supervisor Hermsen, B is apparently in the state statute, and it allows the sheriff to choose, so you can't stop him from choosing no matter what you put in here. This is the way I'm understanding this. So given that, he can do whatever he wants on that one. So in some cases he may decide that it's not worthwhile to pursue reimbursement. You can't get blood out of a turnip. And in other cases, he may decide, yeah, it's worth going after. So all I have done is try to make the language in the rest of this ordinance reflect the fact that he may or may not go after a person.
Supervisor Hermsen.
Thank you. Supervisor Lucky, I agree with what you're saying, and it's correct. However, the sheriff can't go after this stuff until we pass an ordinance for it, is my understanding. That was the reason why this all came to a stop last time. It still comes to us whether we're going to allow the sheriff to go after individuals who may have the resources to pay, let's say. Now, where my trouble comes with this, anyone that is picked up or jailed for any reason, whatever the reason is, it would appear that given this authority to the sheriff, could really end up treating that prisoner differently. If that's a very wealthy person, maybe all of a sudden for a simple, I'm trying to think of a drunk driving ticket, let's say, or they may end up, because of their wealth, being charged 10 times the amount for a ticket that another person may get off scot-free with. Well, it's not for tickets, but it's for costs of the jail. And I don't believe in a society that we have that we treat all individuals the same. So that's why I'm very hesitant with this and was very apprehensive in voting in the affirmative to let it go forward. But now I've got my piece out there and I'll be quiet.
Supervisor Malik.
Counties are creatures of state government, and our authorities are assigned to us by state statutes. I gather from today's discussion that without a county ordinance, there could be no charges passed through to jail inmates, but that the state, in its wisdom, has given the sheriffs a great deal of discretion. The charging of fees is only one area in which sheriffs have a lot of discretion in the management of jails. Recent news accounts have discussed the notorious case of a person named Lindsay Lohan who has done some egregious things in California, but because of situations in the jail, the sheriff has released this person after very short stays, for example. Evidently, they have a jail crowding situation there, plus the requirements to provide security for that person would put an unusual requirement on the jail, which the sheriff was simply unable to meet, and he deemed it in his discretion best to set her free after very short periods of time, contrary in a sense to what the judge seemed to be ordering. That I think is indicative of a situation that exists throughout our country, and St. Croix County is not unusual in that respect. So the bottom line is I don't think we should be unduly excited by seeing that the sheriff has discretion to waive certain fees. When we put it in the context, not simply of budgetary matters, but of other reasons that a sheriff might waive fees. This sheriff has mentioned, for instance, the appropriateness in some cases of providing incentives to students to further their education. You know, we have, in the last few years, created a system of providing incentives that divert people from jail, you know, that have a drug court, and the sheriffs have, this sheriff and his predecessor, have had to step out of some of their more traditional roles and think about innovative ways to reduce recidivism. It's all part of a big picture, and it seems to me that it's perfectly understandable why the state would give the sheriff authority, once we give the sheriff authority to collect fees, the state would give the sheriff authority to waive them in cases that he deems appropriate.
Supervisor Malik, the chair is not familiar with this Lindsay Lohan person. Is this an acquaintance of yours?
All I know is what I see on the news, and it sometimes appears disgusting.
Supervisor Norton Bauman.
Thank you, Board Chair. I have a question about 63.07, which is the last line on this report. Is there a fee schedule that this county board has adopted, or will there be one, or?
It's on the back. It's on the back.
Thank you.
Next page.
Thank you very much.
Supervisor Revels.
Once again, I'd like to say that sometimes boards become masters at micromanaging. The people have voted a sheriff in. It's his job to do the job. Now, he can't do that with all kinds of rules. He has to have some ability and some chance to make decisions that we may not agree with.
Any additional discussion on the amendment? Is there anyone else wishes to speak on the amendment before I call on Supervisor Hermsen, who has already spoken on it? Supervisor Hermsen.
Thank you, Board Chair. I was just going to ask the question, was the in 6302C, 1, 2, 3, and 4, were those included with the may be charged, all four of those?
Yes.
Thank you.
Supervisors, we are ready to vote on the amendment. We are not voting on the resolution. We're voting on the amendment. This, trying to remember, is amendment from Supervisor Lucky, and I don't remember the second. Malik. Second from Malik. Normally,
Did you pick up in your notes, Mr. Chairman, that the will in F was changed to may also?
Yes. And I was about to indicate that normally it is the responsibility to the chair to read back a motion. Because of the length of this one, I'm going to beg your indulgence and not do that. Essentially, we are changing all of the shells to mays, and I think those have all been noted by you. You understand the intent of the resolution. And with no objection, I'm not going to read it back. Supervisors, proceed to vote on the amendment only. And the amendment is approved. At this point, what we have in front of us is an amended ordinance. This ordinance is in front of us on a motion from Supervisor Larson and a second from Supervisor Schrank. Discussion on the amended ordinance. I suspect that took place when we talked about the amendment. Any additional discussion? Supervisor Norton-Bauman.
Thank you. Can I understand, Board Chair, that the fee schedule on the back page is part of this ordinance?
That would be correct, Supervisor.
Yes.
6307 references the fees, and the schedule is in fact attached.
Thank you.
Any additional discussion? If not, we're ready to vote on the amended ordinance. This is an ordinance repealing a previous ordinance, number 614. The year was 2002, and creating Chapter 63, Maintenance and Board of Jail Inmates of the St. Croix County Code of Ordinances. Supervisors, proceed to vote. And the amended ordinance passes unanimously. Agenda item number 5 is a resolution approving the Farmland Preservation Plan. This resolution comes to us from the Community Development Committee, a motion by Supervisor Hermsen and a second from Supervisor Marzoff. Discussion. Any discussion? Fred, is a constituent phoning in with a question?
A constituent just calling, yes. Probably not a question related to the topic at hand.
Supervisor Lucky.
On page 4, at the bottom of the page, is 1.13. Just be interested in hearing some comment from staff or someone regarding that item.
One more time, Supervisor, you are directing attention to page 4
of the plan,
which would be preserving farmland. Point number which?
1.13.
Reading, the county will establish a producer advisory group?
No.
Oh, excuse me, I see it now. The county will amend the St. Croix County zoning ordinance?
Yeah.
Is Bob in the room? Or Pete? See, I was trying to deflect this from you, sir.
You know, that's a great question, and maybe would it be helpful to provide a little bit of context to this? Maybe just a short 2 or 3 minute history on how we got to this point, and then maybe, you know, and then we'll come back and answer that question. First of all, I'd like to thank the citizens, the producers, the staff, and the board, specifically our committee, that had spent quite a bit of time on this farmland preservation plan. And some of the materials you see before you talk about how important farmland is to the county. Actually, it's the number one employer, and in 2010 it provided about $532 million of economic activity. So obviously, farmland is an important piece of our county, even though we've seen some rapid growth in the last 10 years. And so when you look at this plan, I think you want to look at it as what many of our villages and cities have in terms of industrial parks. In a way, we have industrial parks for businesses to grow and expand. And if you look at agriculture as a place or as a part of the economy, as a part of the economy that needs to grow and maintain itself, you need support, you need feedback from the people that are working the land, and you also need to look at the resources, the soils, the so-called green infrastructure that exists. So when you look at this farmland preservation plan, it really provides that guidance for the next 15 years to allow agriculture to maintain and grow itself based on some feedback, guiding principles that have been provided by the community, by the people that are farming the land. Back in 2007 is really when this started. There was a study tour, a number of producers toured Dakota County that has land use tools in place to provide some protection and growth of farmland. In 2008, there were about 8 people from St. Croix County that attended a land use study tour. We went to Pennsylvania, Maryland, and New Jersey, and looked at some of the issues that they were dealing with and trying to deal with growth and expansion, to allow that growth and expansion, but also to protect the agricultural base. And out of that group and out of that learning then came the Wisconsin Department of Agriculture introduced the Working Lands Initiative and passed it in 2009. And it was that Working Lands Initiative then that provided some of the framework from which the Farmland Preservation Plan was born. St. Croix County was asked, along with a handful of other counties, to be some of the first counties to update their Farmland Preservation Plan because of the growth that we were experiencing. Why do we need to update this Farmland Preservation Plan? Well, it's been in existence, the existing one, since 1980. Obviously, things have changed a little bit, and so this updates that old plan, but it also allows producers that are taking tax credits to maintain their eligibility for those tax credits. So the existing farmland preservation plan is set to expire, and so this new plan then acts to then update and maintain that certification with the state. So that, again, is just a short background. The formal process of updating the farmland preservation plan started in about 2010. And between 2010 and today, we've had about 6 workshops, a producer survey, open houses, presentations at Farm City Day, and et cetera. We've had quite a bit of input, quite a bit of teaching and learning. You know, information is flowing both ways between staff and the producers and the public. And so, again, what is before you in this plan then was discussed at a public hearing on the 30th of November. A lot of feedback and conversation at that public hearing, and the changes then that were made to the plan as a result of those comments at the public hearing and during the public comment period are reflected in the draft documents that you have there. And what I'd call your attention to then are some preliminary comments from the Department of Ag. Ultimately, the Department of Ag will certify this plan, and so we received some preliminary comments, addressed those comments. We added language to make sure that the town plans, you know, many towns didn't have plans in 1980, now they do. And this farmland preservation plan recognizes and maintains the town plans for those towns that do have plans. And you'll see that we even changed some language specifically that refers to commercial and industrial uses to say that those uses will be allowed in those areas where the respective town will support it. Again, putting some of that ownership in the town plan and putting some of that decision ability with the towns. There were a number of people that requested to be within the farmland preservation area, and so staff worked to include producers in Somerset, Troy, and Aaron Prairie, and there were some folks that requested to be out of the farmland preservation area, and those were areas in Star Prairie and in Baldwin. So really, quite a bit of work has been put into this. A fair amount of public input has been put into this. And the maps and the farmland preservation area map that you see, the green areas and the white areas, I see Supervisor Larson is taking a look at that. I hope everybody's had a chance to kind of look at that map. Those green areas then reflect areas where producers are eligible to participate in the farmland preservation program. That's what this plan does now. In addition, it outlines goals and objectives that will be used as guiding principles, really, as we move forward over the next 15 years. The next step, if this plan is to be approved by this board and certified by the state, the next step then will be for the Planning and Zoning Department to update the agricultural zoning district in accordance with this farmland preservation plan. And so that would be a whole nother process that would take place in the future. So does that, any questions at all on the process and how we've got to where we are today? So we'll get back to Supervisor Lucky's question. 1.13 on page 4. And your question is?
Microphone, Supervisor.
Just the thinking behind that,
What Supervisor Lucky is asking about, for those of you that don't have a plan in front of you, it's under the goals and objectives are really under, well, there are four broad goals. This one happens to fall under the agricultural policies and under preserving farmland. And it reads, the county will amend, this is 1.13, the county will amend the St. Croix County zoning ordinance to establish zoning standards to set a minimum lot size of 1.5 acres and a maximum lot size of 5.0 acres in the farmland preservation areas. And so what this is providing, and again, I'll turn to some of the staff here too, and catch me if I'm misstepping here, but these will be some guiding principles when we take that next step of updating the ordinance to provide at least a starting point from which to establish lot standards in areas in the farmland preservation zoning areas. So, you know, for example, right now in the ag zoning district, for you to be able to sell, you have to maintain a lot size. It's a minimum lot size of 35 acres. This may allow a smaller lot size in the ag zoning district. It may allow a farmer a little bit more flexibility, a lot more flexibility in some people's mind, to be able to possibly create a lot and not have to create a lot that's 35 acres in size. Again, there's a lot of work that need to be done there, but hypothetically, those would be some guiding principles that we could go into that discussion and talk about some of those opportunities for landowners that have ag-zoned land. And again, at the risk of confusing people, when we go through this process, we won't have exclusive ag zoning, or it won't be ag zoning, it will be called farmland preservation zoning. So just a heads up, the more times you hear it, the more it will sink in, but it will be called farmland preservation zoning.
Any additional discussion or questions? Supervisor Malik.
Well, I've got to ask, how does a change from 35-acre sites to 5-acre sites have the potential to preserve farmland? It appears that it would lead to a lot of parcels, could lead to a lot of parcels of 5-acre size, which are really not even big enough for a hobby farm. Let's see, with animal unit stuff, that might mean one horse or two horses. Not, certainly nothing that would be economically viable as a way to support a family, and would have the potential to chew up a lot of good farmland. And by definition, as I read earlier, the farmland preservation area is through that LESA, land evaluation and site assessment system, chosen to be the fertile, flat, tillable, productive land, probably the kind that most farmers would think in the abstract, and when they weren't thinking about how do I make enough money by selling 5 acres this year so I can send a kid to college or whatever, when they're thinking long term, they would say, gosh, we really don't want to carve our farm up in 5 acre pieces. Yeah, aren't we again, running a philosophical disconnect here?
Yeah, another good question. When you look at farmland, I mean, a farmer's ability to farm the land also has something to do. You know, they're not going to want to cut and divide their property because it impacts their ability to farm that land. But this plan is not. This plan recognizes that there will be significant growth in St. Croix County over the coming years. I mean, it's not a no-growth plan, and the state fully recognizes that there will be growth. And so what's the best way to manage that growth in these areas where towns have decided that they want to maintain farmland? I mean, there will be kids, there will be grandsons and granddaughters that need land. There will be outside people that maybe want to move into those areas. And if there's a way to provide some ability for people to have non-ag, I mean, these quite possibly would be non-farming, the non-farming community, to be able to build a house maybe on the sandy knob or on some unproductive land without the farmer having to sell the whole 35 acres. That may provide some outlet for those people that want to tap into development potential, but what you're seeing here would is probably not look it's probably not the kind of thing that we have seen in other places, probably in the western part of the townships where we've seen major subdivisions. This is not really meant to be a major subdivision type thing. It's maybe meant to be a handful of lots. And actually, Chapter 91 and some of the guidance allows for the creation of a handful of lots for producers that have land that's zoned farmland preservation. So it's creating the framework, again, the ability to allow some minor development, a handful of lots by landowners. Again, lots of work to be done, and there's lots of input from the community that would need to be provided to be able to flush that out in some kind of an ordinance. Did that answer your question? I mean, I
well, are you saying that after subdivision into, let's say, 5-acre lots, the land would remain in farmland preservation zoning when a house is put on?
That would be my understanding. Mm-hmm.
And so the tax incentives, the tax stuff, the good stuff, is still there even while a house sits on it. Only 5 acres?
Well, now you're getting into some specifics about the tax credits. In order to receive tax credits through the farmland preservation program, you have to meet minimum requirements, which is a significant amount of your income. I think it's $8,000 of income needs to be generated from the land. Obviously, there might be some people on 5 acres that have fruit and berry farms that could probably meet that standard. But again, agriculture, by definition, in this plan, is meant to be broad. It's not meant to be just corn and soybeans and dairy, which we have a significant number, but it's meant to be, it could be forestry, it could be aquaculture, it could be vegetable growth, it could be CSAs, community shared agriculture, all those types of things. And certainly on 1.5 to 5 acres, a person could generate that kind of income if they were interested in that tax credit.
Supervisor Norton-Bellman.
Thank you. It seems to me that in this day and age of much larger farms, much larger acreages, that there seems to be a potential for a need for a farmer to be able to sell a lot or create a lot to build housing for, as you said, a son or a grandson or a nephew or somebody that would be able to help farm those acres. So I see that this reduction in lot size from 35 down to a maximum of 5 makes a great deal of sense for me for the future of agriculture in the county.
Additional discussion, comments. Supervisor Lucky.
On page 5, 2.15, are you considering something more than, you know, growing corn for ethanol?
Supervisor Lucky's question, 2.5, for those of you that don't have the plan. The county will promote the development and distribution.
It's 2.15.
Oh, 2.15, sorry.
2.15.
2.15. The county will encourage bioenergy production to diversify energy resources and therefore enhance the agricultural economy. And your question about ethanol is a good one. That would be what I would term as a first generation renewable bioenergy. Certainly cellulosic ethanol, creating biogas, using manure to create biogas, and our projects that are already in place. So ethanol is one, and certainly we've got a lot of producers who are sending corn to the plant in Wheeler. But bioenergy, by definition, is much more broad than just ethanol production.
Any additional comments or discussion? Thank you, Pete. Seeing none, I assume that you are ready to vote. Supervisors, this is a resolution adopting the Farmland Preservation Plan. This is on a motion from Supervisor Hermsen, second by Supervisor Marzoff. Is the second in?
Yep.
proceed to vote on the resolution adopting the Farmland Preservation Plan. And that is approved. Supervisor Harmsen.
Could I take a moment to thank the committee as far as chair and community development, and also thank staff on all the long hours that we put into this, and the staff's work with arranging the community input and well, just all the work. It's been a long process, and it's been a lot of time spent with the committee to bring this forward. So I'd like to thank them, everyone on the committee, for doing that.
Absolutely. Thank you for those comments. At this point, supervisors, I think we will take a short break before we proceed with our agenda. We will stand informal for 10 minutes. Supervisors, we are back in session. Agenda item number 6 is an ordinance repealing Chapter 41, metal or glass, Chapter 43, recycling, and Chapter 44, storage of waste tires, and creating Chapter 21, St. Croix County Municipal Solid Waste Reduction, Recovery, and Recycling of the St. Croix County Code of Ordinances. This ordinance comes to us after public hearings from the Community Development Committee, and Chair would entertain a motion. Motion from Committee Chair Harmsen, and a second from Supervisor, Committee Member, and Supervisor Marzoff. Discussion. Supervisor Harmsen.
Could we have, yes, could we have Ellen Denzer, our senior planner, come forward to answer any questions on this and maybe to go over a little detail of where we're at with it?
Good suggestion. Ellen?
I'll be brief. Thank you. This document has been a long time in the making. It has been actually under three different committees that have reviewed it, made changes, suggested direction, and throughout that time frame, you can see in the summary sheet we provided you, and I hope you all have your copy of that, that this really started shortly after 2007, officially started in 2008. This document replaces three ordinances. It is only applicable in the responsible units, which are 26 members municipalities. There are other municipalities in our county that have chosen to be their own responsible units, and they would administer their responsibilities regarding recycling as the state requires in their own way. We do receive grant funds, as you're all who our members are aware, and those funds are given back to the municipalities in two different checks we give out, you know, twice a year. And we do have to have an effective recycling program to continue to get those funds and to continue to maximize those funds. And we do a very good job in working with our local municipalities to do the very best we can to get them as much assistance as they can possibly receive based under the program. And it does take a lot of effort to make sure that all the paperwork is in order and all the paperwork is filed in appropriate time frames, and we try to do our very best to do that. As to this ordinance and why, we knew that in back after we were required by the state to do this compliance assurance plan that our ordinance, our existing ones, were not in compliance with statutory and administrative code changes. And throughout this process, we've actually had two or three additional changes that we've had to keep changing to keep up. And so this document really needed, the old documents really needed updating. And we did a lot of effort to try to make sure that we weren't just going through and slapping in some quick changes, that we were responding to any issues that local municipalities felt we should address. So we did back in, starting in 2008, and have continuously done that since then, had meetings where we invited all the haulers in, we invited the local municipalities in, we invited the citizens in, and asked them, what are any issues you'd like us to look at? What are any concerns you'd like us to address? And some of those concerns were things like littering and dumping in ditches and burning, which are we get a lot of complaints and phone calls and concerns about. So those are a couple of the things we've addressed, and we've repeatedly throughout this process tried to pull together public input. For instance, the newsletter that we do that goes out to every household in St. Croix County, we've had this ordinance mentioned in that newsletter a couple different times, once in 2008 and once in 2009. So we've always tried to do that. We've had the ordinance, various drafts on the internet ever since 2009 and 2010 and 2011. So there's always been opportunity for people to comment, look at it, and we have gotten comments. And we have made changes. Based on the public hearing, a lot of the changes that were made were in response to issues that our haulers in the county brought up. And we tried to address everything that they were concerned about. We've summarized those changes, again, on their handout. We've limited most of the labeling that people wanted, and we've limited most of the requirements for the haulers down to just pretty much the bare minimum that they need to do. Really struck a lot out of that section. And I could go through these, but we really did try to be very responsible to what the haulers need in order to keep operating in a very cost-effective manner. And we realize things are tough now. Things have gotten more tight for municipalities as far as those who are doing contracts. Things have gotten tight financially for individual property owners who are individually contracting with haulers. And so we've tried to be responsive to those issues and those concerns. We've tried to clarify where things were confusing. And we hope that we've done a good job of that. And as I said, it's been through a lot of review. It did come to this county board back in 2010, some of you might remember that, and was sent back to committee for additional changes. And the committee spent quite an exhaustive time addressing those issues, plus additional issues that were brought up by the committee members themselves. So I hope that we can answer any questions you have today, and hopefully we've tried to be responsible and make an ordinance that will really work. So I will stop with that and ask if anyone has any questions they'd like me to answer. Certainly, Supervisor Horn.
So the document of changes, is that the changes from the current ordinance or the changes from the originally proposed Chapter 1?
Those changes are from the public, were taken, those are things that were taken out of the public hearing draft or changed in the public hearing draft, and the document before you has all those changes in it.
So do we have a document showing us the changes of what's being proposed today from what from the current ordinance, recycling ordinance?
No, you don't have one that's like a tract of everything from the current recycling ordinance. No, I don't have that. Because there also are three different documents. One deals with metal and glass, and the other deals with tires, and all that's been rolled together into one document.
All right. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I've gone through this, and I have on several issues, concerns. First of all, a trash and recycling ordinance hearing was held on November 30th of this year. And for those of you who weren't able to attend that, it was standing room only. And the citizens were spilling out into the hallways, which is somewhat rare for a hearing that the county holds. And the majority of the people there were not at all happy with the ordinance. And since then, a fellow has even taken out an ad in the newspaper, a paid advertisement, and set up a website expressing his concern. And I have received emails and letters. The document, incidentally, the document that you have in front of you is not the same one that was at the hearing on November 30th. It's been changed since then. Improvements were made to it, but it has never been back to another public hearing. So this version today is, you know, sort of the first time we're seeing the so-called final product. So why are people so riled? And I think that one big reason that people are so upset is the inspection provisions on page 21-15. People just don't believe that what's in their trash can or their recycling bin is important enough to give government the right to snoop through it, either while it's sitting out in their yard or out at the curb waiting for collection. And whether or not you mistakenly put a number 7 plastic in your recycling bin doesn't strike people as a good enough reason to permit government to search your property or search your trash can or your recycling bin. People feel that government searches should be limited to really serious matters. So if you take a look at this page 21-15, at the top it says see inspections. Inspection for compliance. And basically, under A there, it's listing what government has a right to inspect. And when you see the words municipal solid waste throughout this, that's sort of code for trash, recyclable material, banned materials, separated materials, and construction and demolition material. So number one says municipal solid waste. So basically that's pretty wide open. We're going to inspect trash. It doesn't say where. Last time this was, one of these ordinances was before us, I brought up the issue that did people really want government coming into their kitchen or their basement or their garage or whatever, you know, going through their trash to see if they accidentally mixed up their recyclables or something. And this number one is pretty wide open. I mean, I think that could probably, some lawyer could probably construe that to mean that you the government could look at your trash wherever. It doesn't have any limit on it. Then number two, where it talks about municipal solid waste collection sites and facilities, well, in the lingo of this ordinance, a collection site is basically, it could be where you put your can out at the curb, or it could be the dumpster outside your apartment building, that sort of thing. Three, they can inspect hauler vehicles. Four, they can, wherever the trash is congregated in a, say, an apartment or non-residential property, they can, you know, come in and go through, paw through that. And then in number five, this is where they come into your yard. They have the right to come into your yard, excluding, you know, looking around agricultural structures. And then, of course, B and C say that they have to get your, they should ask your permission and they should identify themselves, fine. D, if you don't give them permission, then they can go before a judge to get a special inspection warrant to come in without your permission, which, since that's in statute, you know, you could, if you read that statute, you can do that for most any sort of government situation. And then E, if they find a violation, you know, they'll commence enforcement. F, they're peering into your trash can or your recycling container. It says that they can go through it before it's put on the truck, essentially. So I looked at all of that and I thought, well, you know, that we do need to, as a government, be able to deal with serious situations. you know, things that might affect public health, safety, welfare, the environment, pose some type of hazard. But does government really need to be snooping through your trash to see whether, you know, you've got the wrong number of plastic mixed in with the kind you're allowed to put in there, and so on and so forth? So I decided to see if I could tackle a rewrite of that section to try to make it a little less onerous for people and their rights in their own property, and still, while still trying to preserve government authority to handle the really serious situations. So I'm going to pass out my attempt at that, and I am going to...
Supervisor, are you going to be offering this as an amendment?
Yes.
So you are handing out the written language that you will propose in a motion as an amendment?
Yes.
Proceed.
Thank you.
Supervisors, I will inquire, while Supervisor Lucky is distributing the information, you have heard the general concept of what she's handing out. I inquire, is there a second of her motion to strike language and insert what she's handing out? You are seconding? The language that is now being handed out comes to us on a motion from Supervisor Lucky with a second from Supervisor Sather. And Supervisor Lucky, I am assuming that the language that you have handed out, which indicates Section C inspections, is an entire replacement. Your motion to amend is to strike all language and insert the language that you have distributed?
Yes, from C1A down through F. And so basically, what I did was I removed the wide open municipal solid waste in the old number one. I removed two because that's basically, you know, looking out at the curb and looking in apartment buildings and so forth. I left number three in, hauler vehicles. I inserted a new one which would allow us to inspect any site or facility to which multiple loads of municipal solid waste are brought in case someone starts up some type of, haulers start a new collection facility somewhere, or somebody starts having municipal solid waste trucked to a field somewhere or whatever. I took out your yard and I said instead of that a site exterior to a single family or multi-family dwelling excluding agricultural structures or on non-residential property, if municipal solid waste on the site poses a threat to public health, safety, or the environment, or creates a nuisance, an eyesore, an unsanitary condition, or a fire hazard, or is being burned or buried. Those words, I believe, allow us to go after the serious situations that really are government's concern. I left the rest B, I put combined, let's see, I combined B and two of these into one, so the words are all still there. And I got rid of them peering into your trash can in number F.
You're concluded?
For the moment.
Discussion on the amendment. And the amendment would be to strike the section that you see and insert the new language. Discussion and comments. Supervisor Peavy.
Yes, my question for Supervisor Lucky is on the burned or buried part. My concern would be agricultural use. I use the example of clearing fence lines, where we push the brush, which does qualify as municipal solid waste, into a pile, burn it, and then bury the scrap. Was your intent to include that, or could you suggest some wording to exclude that? Thank you.
The wording that was in here says in five, do you see the, do you have the number, the old number five there? It says, this is the one where they, it says any open space or yard area adjoining only residential structures. And I understood that the Peavy amendment was this does not include agricultural structures. So I tried to retain that in what I wrote, and I put in here excluding agricultural structures.
Supervisor Marzoff.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Supervisor Lucky, I respect you for your concerns and your attempt at having this wording comply with your thoughts on the issue. My concern all along with respect to recycling and so on is the presence of heavy metals in our waste stream, such as that from the mercury in fluorescent lights, from other heavy metals found in electronics that sometimes get stashed into the trash. And I just hope that the wording that you're recommending will still permit the inspection for the possible contamination of our landfills by these heavy metals. Does it?
Well, it permits, you know, inspection of hauler vehicles and any place, you know, that they might want to take it. Certainly, a lot of this has to do with education, and I see that that is promoted throughout the ordinance in terms of the haulers giving people information each year as to why they should recycle and what items are banned. And I know the staff does an excellent job with their newsletter of reinforcing that. The media does that too. So really educating people as to the dangers of some of these things is really the key. We work with our children in the schools, and I think that that is what's going to do the trick for us, just making people aware of how serious these things are, the things that can actually harm us.
Supervisors, the amendment that is proposed in front of us is not insignificant. It removes an entire section and inserts a new section. So before we proceed any farther, I'm going to inquire of staff as to their interpretation of what the effect would be if this, in fact, would be approved. Are they supportive of the change in the language? Give us an evaluation of the effect of the change, because as you previously heard, this has been a process that has been underway for an extended period of time, and there is nothing that is placed before us today that is, shall we say, cavalier. It has gone through an intense amount of scrutiny, And so I inquire of staff as to their reaction to the amendment.
The amendment is extensive and would change things, I agree, quite a bit. The our understanding, the committee's understanding, based on working with legal counsel and trying to respond to the concern that were brought up by the county board previously, as Supervisor Lucky mentions, she was concerned about whether or not there would be people looking in trash cans in homes. And our understanding was the way it was rewritten as presented would not allow any inspection of interior structures of homes or residential properties. We did want to retain the interior inspection of not residential portions, but interior multifamily and non-residential properties, because many times they have indoor collection of various types of things, you know. And so that's why it wasn't limited to open space, yard area, exterior only for multifamily or non-residential. And this would be a change to that. This would say, no, you can't look at the municipal waste collection area of a multifamily or non-residential property even if it's interior. For instance, the government center here, not that we're going to inspect here, but as an example, all of our waste is collected, and it's a big building, it's a big facility, it's collected and stored indoors. It's not stored exterior. That's an example. So that would be a big change. This also was not intended. We have had an ordinance that allows inspection of, for instance, multifamily and non-residential, and has since 1994, and we have never issued any citations actually under that existing ordinance. We've never felt the need to check whether people were actually truly recycling all of ones and twos or not, or mistakenly throwing away ones and twos in garbage. In fact, the way the state law is written, the purpose of an ordinance, by having an ordinance and by having an effective recycling program, the state realizes that there's always going to be a few things that get mixed in. And if you have an effective recycling program where you try to capture the majority or as much as you possibly can of recyclable materials, then mixing in a few recyclables by mistake is absolutely allowed. In fact, that is, the statutes are written very in what might be considered a very convoluted manner, but they actually say if you have an effective recycling program, then you're allowed to have things that you miss. So we would not enforce that, because that's the point of the statutes, and that's reflected in us having an ordinance. We all know that people walk into a place, an activity, an event, a sporting event or something like that, there's no recycling container handy, and they throw that pop can into the garbage. And that's not illegal, and never has been in this state, if we have an effective recycling program, and an ordinance is a component of that. The reason that we tried to be much more clear and specific as we rewrote, and the committee understood this from our examples and our explanations, this whole inspection and compliance section, is because we also were asked, and this was specifically as a result of our public input by the towns and even by some of the haulers, that we address issues outside of recycling plastics and recycling aluminum and that kind of thing, that we have help, that the municipalities have help in dealing with the issues that come up regarding dumping, whether it's, and it's not always in the ditches, which is already a public part of a road. We had extensive problems in this county with dumping on lots, private, empty, unbuilt lots. People know where those are, they drive up and they unload. And if you can't inspect that municipal solid waste on that private lot, it's very hard to pursue that person and try to get that person to pay for that cleanup. And right now, that's being absorbed by local municipalities. So that was one issue. Another issue is the whole concern about people have a lot of health issues regarding burning. And there's a lot of things that are burned that do give off gases that really affect people with various health problems like asthma and things like that. And that was another area where we wanted to do a better job of sending that message. And I don't really think we're going to be doing a lot of issuing citations. That is absolutely not our intent. We are still a one-person recycling specialist with backup by the rest of our department. And those concerns will all be addressed more in a proactive, in alerting people, following up. And yeah, there may be when we can finally capture someone because we can look through the garbage, look through the trash, look through the issues, and maybe figure out who dumped. We will try to do a little more of that. And that was added, at the request of our municipalities, and that's why this section was made more thorough. We didn't say take off the term solid waste, municipal solid waste, because that's what people dump, whether it's, couches, chairs, bags of garbage, dirty diapers, anything. That's where they bury the, like someone else mentioned, Supervisor Malzahn, that's where they bury the electronics or the things that they don't want to get rid of properly. And we all understand people face financial costs, but there are an awful lot of really good programs in this county to get rid of, especially those hazardous wastes, free of charge, if you're just willing to wait patiently until we can have our collection programs. So this was rewritten with those intents in mind. And we do get issues with the multifamily and non-residential, and we've, again, tried to do a lot of education. We had a whole program with a limited-term employee about 3-4 years back who we went out to the apartment buildings and tried to work with the owners and work with the organizations and try to improve that. And we did improve it a lot, but there's always room for more. And so this change, while I certainly understand the concerns, we were at the public hearing, we heard the issues, we understood what people had to say. Our committee had a follow-up meeting in December in which a lot of citizens with the same issues attended and did bring up some of those concerns, and we had a pretty good discussion about that. Talked about the fact that this inspection warrant is available right now already. Inspection warrants are very hard to get. Any kind of warrant is. I'm sure our corporation counsel could address that. You have to have some really serious concerns before you could get that. It would not be related to a minor inspection. And if this change was made, some of it is probably very good ideas. I'm kind of responding on the fly here. But one of the concerns I would have is if you were only able to look at solid waste at a collection facility where multiple loads were dumped, there would be very little ability to go back and work with that property owner or property owners who may have been the ones who were in violation, throwing away electronics or throwing away something hazardous, that kind of thing. There'd be very little way to actually go back and follow up. Certainly a hauler could contact us and say, hey, I think I just picked up from someone and I think that, you know, there's something nasty in there. But if they didn't hesitate, if they didn't wait, again, it'd be very hard to follow up. So I think that the intent is certainly very important, and I understand the concerns that people had. I think that what's written here is already what would happen. We don't have the time to be following up on whether or not people are recycling. And again, that's not the intent of the state law, and that's not the intent of our program. And it's not really illegal, so that's not the issue. The intent is those very serious situations, and I know you may, and you're certainly right when you say, well, intent could be compromised by various employees who don't have good intentions, and I certainly understand that concern. But I think that the state law, while complicated, is pretty clear that, and that's part of what we wrote on some of that explanation about why some changes were not made. You really seriously, if you don't have an ordinance and you don't try to encourage recycling and do all the positive things you can, you actually limit people from even disposing of landfills in this state. So I guess I can't completely say that, you know, we'd be for it or against it. I just have to say that it does make some big changes, and those would have to be discussed. And of course, we try to follow what policy direction is provided to us and try to just find positive and appropriate ways to deal with what you guys want us to do. So that's kind of a vague, but it's a little hard on the fly to give you details.
Supervisor Malik.
Frankly, I've got some concerns, although I think that the amendment is an improvement over the original. I think it still fails to address some important features. The first is, so I've got a suggestion, but I'd like to indicate what some of those issues are and see if some of the rest of you don't agree that we still haven't quite captured it here. The first is, I think that the inspection ought to follow a reason to suspect there's a problem. In other words, I believe we've all talked around this and thought about the possibility of a rogue planning and zoning department employee, and it's somewhat worrisome. I think that's behind what Supervisor Lucky articulated as the government coming in to inspect. But we'd feel more comfortable if there was some provision in here that this inspection could happen only if there was a reason to suspect a violation. Perhaps talking about if they had received a complaint. So if the committee gets a chance to look at this again, I would suggest they think in terms of borrowing some of that language that probably Alfie is familiar with, a reasonable suspicion kind of stuff that has to do in the criminal area of our law with when entry to a structure could be made or when a search can be made, some reason to suspect based on a complaint or other evidence. Secondly, I think there's been some discussion here about the multifamily dwelling and how there are legitimate reasons to make inspections in multifamily dwellings, but we're probably talking not about the apartments themselves, but as much as we're talking about the hallways or the shared spaces. If you think in terms of the language in a condominium declaration where you have spaces that everybody can use, that's where the collecting stuff would normally be located, and that's where the inspections ought to be made. So I don't think we should exclude all multifamily dwellings, but we should exclude the residences, but include the ability to inspect in the common spaces. And a third thing, I think with respect to Supervisor Peavy's representation of the farmers and burning brush under appropriate circumstances and burying the residue, I don't think this language, either of these, the original that the committee gave us or the Lucky Amendment, has yet given the kind of protection that farmers need for that burning. So my recommendation, if quite frankly, is that we send this back to the committee with those thoughts and to work on them and come up with something that's even better still. And to that end, I think what I need to do is to make a motion to table for the committee to return with a revision.
Is there a second? Motion to table is a priority motion that is not debatable. The motion that has just been made is to table the entire ordinance for the revision consideration that you have just suggested and Supervisor Lucky has suggested. And Mr. Peavy. I missed who was the second? Is Lauren second in there? Supervisors, at this point we're voting on a priority motion to table the ordinance and send it back for the suggestions and the revisions that have been articulated. This comes on a motion from Supervisor Malik, second from Supervisor Sather. Proceed to vote on the motion to table. And the motion to table is withheld, upheld.
Board Chair.
Supervisor Hermsen.
The Chair of Community Development would like to have some additional instruction, if possible, from the board as far as, I mean, you just outlined one section here being the inspection for compliance and the other being the, help me, Buck, what was the, I think on the burning portion?
Burning. The agricultural burning.
Yep.
Shared spaces, reasonable suspicion. It's all relating to the inspection.
So.
Nothing else in the ordinance that substantially criticized my opinion.
Okay, so I.
Supervisor Harmsen, in the interest of efficiency, I think the presenters of the information are aware of your need, and I would ask them to make sure that that information is provided to the CDC committee and to planning and zoning as they consider revisions. Supervisor Lucky?
I did have several other issues that I wanted to address, and.
And at this point, Supervisor, we have tabled the ordinance, so my request will be that you provide that information to the CDC committee as they consider revisions and return of this ordinance for our consideration.
Okay.
I don't see any way to continue this dialogue.
Right. I was just going to say, well, do you want me to list some other areas of concern?
And pass them on to the committee.
As long as we're going to work on it.
Mr. Chair?
Supervisor Sather?
My only additional request is because this is the differences between the old program or recycling ordinance we had and this changes, or all these changes, in addition to the trash police exemption we were talking about. The document that we have here before us is even more far-reaching and changed a lot from the public hearing in this, all these changes they listed, deleted, changed. And I don't know if it got back to the town boards. I had some town board people or supervisors call me and say that they would have liked to have seen this finished product before today. And so I think they need to be included, because there's been, if I brought all the changes and all the copies of the proposed ordinance, this ordinance that we've had in the last 4 years, I mean, it's be this high. From the original 8-page document to this is amazing. And my question also would be, how hard would it be to, and I did this in committee, change our old document and just bring it into compliance to call it an effective program? I think there's a lot of changes and simplifications that can be made.
Ellen, you've obviously heard all of this. At the risk of misspeaking, and if I do, correct me, my interpretation of what we're about to embark on here with the action to table and a considerable amount of work that's going to go back into this document prior to it coming back here, I suspect that we're going to be required to go to public hearing again. All of which then, this information, distribution to the town boards, much of what's been articulated here would take place in another public hearing process, correct?
Correct.
Supervisor Harmsen.
Thank you, Board Chair. Chairing the CDC and knowing that I feel now that I could almost retire on this document, be given 4 years working on it, I would appreciate if I could get from the board an agreement on either an up-down vote at our March meeting. That would be our last meeting as part of.
Supervisor, I would suspect that we're not going to be able to complete the public hearing process and have it back here in March.
I believe we could.
Be correct, Ellen and Pete?
I don't know. We'll have to look at it. Maybe you've got the month of February. We can try.
Okay, Supervisor, continue.
So I'm just asking that rather than to hand this over to the next board, that we take it as an up-down vote. This has just gone on long enough, and I'll tell you, anybody that wants to sit through these public hearings on this, come on in and join the fun.
Supervisor Malik.
You know, I would not concede that this is such a substantial change that it needs another public hearing. I think that we are manipulating concepts that are already present in the version that came out of the last public hearing. And this is something Don can wrestle with.
Well, I don't think we need to answer that today. You're right. I was suggesting that in my interpretation we probably do, but if we don't, great. So Don and staff will need to make that determination.
Ms. Lucky basically took language that was already present and put it in different order. And the issues about what gets inspected and who does, on what grounds they do the inspection have been discussed before and are embedded in language that was in the previous version and tweaked slightly in the Lucky version and proposed to be tweaked further. I don't think that's significantly different from what the public has seen and commented on before.
Opinion noted. Supervisor Lucky.
Well, the only thing is, though, the public never got a chance to see this version at a hearing, you know, the version we have today, and we're going to change it again, and it might be very instructive for the committee to, before it gets to the county board again, to have that hearing and then an opportunity to do any further tweaking right after the hearing.
Supervisors, I think at this point I'm going to stop this discussion because we're now starting to debate whether or not to have a public hearing, which is not on the agenda, and I'm wading into an area where I'm a little uncomfortable. Don, if, in connection with staff, will determine whether or not we need to have a public hearing and will be so informed. Supervisor Marzoff.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. With all due respect, Supervisor Lucky, if I'm not mistaken, at the hearing, at the most recent public hearing this was discussed, the issue of putting the document on the website was requested from the audience, and the zoning department complied with that, so they have had access to it.
It's tabled.
Now, supervisors, at this point, we're concluded with that. We've tabled this for until a future date, so we will take it up at the earliest opportunity. Supervisors, agenda item number 7. This is a resolution approving an advisory referendum question relating to the county nursing home. This resolution comes to us from the Health and Human Services Committee. Chair would entertain a motion. Motion from Supervisor Wentz and a second from Supervisor Schrenk. Supervisors, before we begin our discussion, I would like to frame the question that's in front of us. And the question is exactly what is titled in the heading on the resolution. Whether or not we should have a referendum relating to the county nursing home. With as much prior notice as possible, and with all due respect, if that should occur, I would caution us from wandering off into the weeds on this resolution. There are a number of side issues, none of which are in debate. We are not debating the quality of the home, the length of time we've been in the business, the labor costs of the staff. We're not debating any of those issues. The resolution that's in front of us is whether we should or should not approve an advisory referendum for the April ballot. And I would respectfully ask all supervisors to address that point, speak in the affirmative or speak in the negative, but reasons why we should or should not have a referendum. Having said that, discussion. Supervisor Hermsen.
Thank you, Board Chair. Before we get started on this, I'd like to make a request that...
State your request.
My request would be asking if Mayor Horn would be willing to step out of the equation of discussion due to his position with the City of New Richmond and the negotiations that they've taken with the Deerfield complex. I think that since the City of New Richmond, of which the mayor is representing, has taken the position of allowing bond dollars or the bond authority of the city for the Deerfield, and that discussions have gone on with the Deerfield, that really, I believe a person sitting in that position should probably excuse themselves from a position on this side where they could either be granting or denying levy dollars that would compete with the Deerfield. So I believe that, I guess I'm going to ask if the mayor would so to recuse himself from this agenda item.
Supervisor, I think all I can do is ask the mayor whether he thinks he should recuse himself or not.
Yeah. At this time, I guess I don't feel I need to, but I'm not opposed to either. I mean, it's discussions we've had with Deerfield.
The discussions we've had with Deerfield have basically nothing to do with the county nursing home, and I think the public has known that I've been a very strong supporter of the county nursing home. So at this time, I don't feel the need. But Corp Counsel?
The rules and bylaws indicate that a supervisor may abstain from voting. So it's up to Supervisor Horn to determine whether or not he wishes to abstain from voting.
But the onus would be on the supervisor whether or not he wishes to abstain.
Correct.
Supervisor, do you or do you not wish to abstain? I'll just ask you directly then.
I guess at this time, no.
Okay.
If Supervisor Hermsen has other concerns, I'm more than interested in hearing.
I think we've dealt with it. And
okay. I'm not really going.
Yeah. Supervisor Marzoff.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'd like to begin by saying that I support this resolution. And prior to this morning's meeting, I put at your place a copy of a letter that we all, not all of us here, but the county board received in the summer of 2008. Prior to the initial referendum as to whether or not we should continue to support the nursing home with revenue from the levy. If you would get that document in front of you, I would just like to highlight two items that I think are important. They are already highlighted in your document, and for the public record, I will read what it says. Again, this is from Colleen Bates, the vice chair of the Eau Claire County Board and the chair of the Health and Human Services Committee for Eau Claire County.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to call a point of order, please. I believe that your instructions to us were that we were only to discuss the advisory resolution in front of us. This letter discusses selling a county nursing home.
I understand your point, and Supervisor, I was carefully listening to the points being made by Supervisor Marzoff to determine if his comments were germane. I was still thinking that they were, but I want to keep him on point with the letter. I want to allow the maximum latitude, but still keep focused. I'm going to overrule your point of order and allow the supervisor to continue, but keep it germane to the question that's in front of us today, Supervisor, and that's whether or not we should have a referendum in 2012. Proceed.
Thank you sincerely, Mr. Chair. In my opening remark, I said I am in favor of the resolution, and therefore I deem that the comments that I'm about to make are relevant to that referendum question.
Proceed cautiously.
Okay. I call your attention to the first highlight on page one. In 1997, by a vote of one margin, the Eau Claire County Board voted to sell the center. That is the health center in Eau Claire. The most salient point relates to what the chairman of the Health and Human Service Committee, I think, was after at the time we drafted the resolution that you have in front of you, and that is we need to put this issue to rest once and for all. We thought we did that in 2008, but again, we seem to be arguing among ourselves as to whether or not the nursing home warrants continued support from the levy. Her closing remark on page 3, there will always be those who believe the county did the right thing to sell the county nursing home. However, the impact of that decision has significantly escalated our county human services cost and, more importantly, denied the appropriate level of care to the individuals for whom we are responsible.
Supervisor, I understand your point, but the resolution that is in front of us does not deal with the sale of the nursing home. So at this point, with all due respect, I'm going to ask you to conclude your remarks on Colleen Bates's letter.
I have concluded those remarks. I have one more comment.
Thank you. Proceed.
In November of 2008, our constituents spoke with unequivocal clarity when, in every single jurisdiction of our county, they voted by at least a 2-to-1 margin to continue to fund with levy dollars the operation of our 5-star rated county nursing home. Conspicuous by its absence in the wording of that 2008 referendum question was the word partially, which, as you will note this time around, has been included in the referendum question you have before you. The rationale for the insertion of the word partially is that funding for operating of our nursing home is derived from multiple sources, which include Medicare, Medicaid, IGT, that stands for intergovernmental transfer dollars that come to us from the state and are awarded to various county-run nursing homes, private pay, fundraising, and donated dollars. I think it's critical, based on what I have heard at public hearings, complaints from the public saying that because only one newspaper in the county carries the proceedings of this board's actions, many of our constituents are uninformed. And I'm saying this as a matter of public record now, that the referendum question on which people will vote in April explicitly now states we will partially fund the nursing home with the levy dollars that are used for that. Thank you.
Comments, discussion? Supervisor Sather.
My only comment is that I suspect that the motivation behind this resolution is to get a non-binding referendum answer to a question that's already been asked. I suspect that the result's probably going to be the same. I think the majority of the people will support funding the nursing home. And whether or not the public is informed, I mean, one of the things they ought to know is that, you know, we've got 75 to 100 empty beds in the whole county. They always bring up the fact that it's a 5-star rated nursing home. In my 25 years of my career working with veterans, I've been in every nursing home in the county, and I feel that all 9 or 10, I don't remember the latest numbers, they're all 5-star. They're all wonderful. They're all caring, clean, healthy, loving places for nursing homes. I think this is just a waste of levy dollars to ask the same question. I suspect they're going to get the same result. It's going to be supporting. But the real question is, do we really need the nursing home? Because there are other beds available. And being on the administration committee, we've got a 76 building that's in tough shape. Whether or not we stay in the business or not, we're going to have to invest in some bricks and mortar, and we have to decide where we're going to invest and whether or not we can afford it. And I think that this is just redundant. I think we'll get the same result. I think they would. But is it our best interest to support a nursing home that may not be necessary?
Supervisor, you are speaking in opposition to the question in front of us. I inquire only because Supervisor Marzoff indicated he was speaking in favor, and as much as possible, I'm going to try and balance speakers I call on, affirmative and negative, in the interest of fairness. Discussion? Comments? Supervisor Norton-Bauman?
Thank you, Board Chair. I'm here to speak against this resolution for an advisory referendum. I think that we had one, and I know we had one in 2008. I think that since the time we had it, those of us who've been on the board that long have gone back and forth trying to figure out what exactly it said other than, yes, we want you to support a public nursing home. Did not state where, did not state that it was the St. Croix County Nursing Home in New Richmond. It was pretty vague. Consequently, I do believe that if we have another advisory referendum, I agree with Supervisor Sather that probably it will pass. Most likely the citizens will say, yes, we want you to support a nursing home. Then those of us who might yet be on this board for another 2 years, I'm not sure, good Lord willing or not, will again have 2 years to argue about what it means. I went to the Health and Human Services Board quite routinely this past year, and I suggested to them on more than one occasion that if they really want a definitive answer from the public for the board to use in making decisions concerning the home, I would advise them that they need a binding referendum that says to this board, for X number of years, we want you to spend X number of dollars in sole support of the nursing home over and above your regular levy. That is what I would be ready to support down the road. I cannot support this today.
Supervisor Wentz.
As you know, I have always been a proponent of our St. Croix nursing home, and I still am very strongly so. I feel that although we had a advisory referendum and it was a 2-to-1 vote that they want to support it, that has not translated to our supervisors here who would not support the nursing home. I think one of the reasons that we're looking to ask for another referendum, and there's no doubt we are taking a chance because in this economy and the way voters feel, we may not be able to sustain their vote again in support of the nursing home. I deep down feel that they will support it because we offer something that, while yes, others' nursing homes are good, they're clean, they give care, we are considered to be a 5-star, not by our own terminology, but by the state and those that come in and regulate us and inspect
Supervisor
us.
Supervisor would indicate we're not arguing about the quality.
I just wanted to make,
quality's
I wanted
good.
To tell them how that came about. It's not because we say it is. My feeling is we need to have our voters say to us once again, yes, we will support it. We're giving them more information. We're saying it is a St. Croix County nursing home. It's located in the city of New Richmond. It also is going to take this much money. And I think that's an important part of this. I think all of us tend to think that what we do in our own way of voting is very, very important to us. It's also important to our constituents. And to say, no, we're not going to have a referendum and give them a chance to vote and put their message out there, do we want it or don't we, is saying, I'm smarter than my constituents and I know what's best for them, so therefore I will vote one way or the other. I think as supervisors, we owe it to the people that we represent to vote so that they have a chance to tell us what do they think. What are their wishes? It's their money, not our money. We tend to spend their money pretty well. However, we need to give them a chance to speak and to speak clearly to us. Granted, it's advisory. However, I think in this economy, the way it is now, it's going to speak louder than anything else. And I would urge you to listen, give your constituents a chance to have their say. Let's put this referendum out there. Let's let them vote.
Supervisor Hermsen.
Thank you, Board Chair. You know, I don't know if anybody watched the movie that came out a little while ago, but the movie was 1776, and I watched that over the weekend. There was a great quote in there. It said, a representative owes the people not only his industry, but his judgment. And he betrays them if he sacrifices it to their opinion. Now, we have a job dealing with levy dollars. We are the ones that make those choices of what gets done. I think the resolution says it very clearly. We don't need to be doing the nursing home. Our levy dollars are things that we absolutely have to do. And we know that a number of things I believe, have been let slide because of what we have been granting the levy dollars to the nursing home. And we don't seem to be very consistent in our approach to it. I'm going to, first example, Board Chair, you, Supervisor Larson, and myself, we sat on the negotiation committee with the labor unions. And the resolution that came before us from Health and Human Services back on May 13th that was passed unanimously from the HHS board said, now therefore be it resolved that the St. Croix County Board of Supervisors directs the administration committee to pursue negotiations pertaining to wages and fringe benefits with the health center employees bargaining unit to enable continued operation of the health center without county levy. That was a direction that was given to us. And Board Chair, wouldn't you agree that we abided by that? Would you, I guess, we were under a constraint to do that.
Supervisor, I should not be entering this debate, but I think you're asking me as chairman of the negotiations committee?
Correct. I want to hear what was our charter and what was the outcome that we came away with the understanding of how we would handle the nursing home.
Well, from the standpoint speaking for the three of us, I believe our charge was what you articulated. That we were charged with entering into conversation with the bargaining unit from the nursing home to attempt to achieve concessions from them to achieve operations without the need for levy dollars by the end of 2012. I believe that was our charge. And we did, in fact, do that. Is that your question?
That's where I'm going with this, is that there would be no levy dollars for the nursing home in 2012. Now, looking back over the minutes of the HHS board, even going back as far as from what I could see in July or August-October time frame, I'm looking at it, the HHS board knew for 2011, that's what we were negotiating for 2011 as well. From that contract that we negotiated with rolled back to the January 1st of 2011 is what we bargained with the union. We set that in place, and what I'm finding amazing is reading through the HHS minutes is that they recognized.
Supervisor, you are in fact speaking to the question whether we should or should not have a referendum, correct?
We are asking the voters for levy dollars when this board has already voted to say that we're not going to give levy dollars to the nursing home. Why would we turn around now and ask a question of the voters to give them levy dollars when the direction has been set all year long? But the important part that I see is the reason we're at this quandary right now is because the nursing home is in a deficit position. So they're coming forward and saying, well, please, can we have more dollars? What I'd like to know is why we're at a point of asking the vote, even trying to entertain a question like this, when there should have been, given their reports that they've gave in the minutes, there should have been actions taken by the HHS board and the staff up there to correct the situation where there would not have been a need for levy dollars. They acknowledge it in their minutes. They acknowledge the fact that, and we have consultants, two of them, that have suggested to them what they can do to correct the need for levy, and they've ignored it. I feel that this is an improper question to even be put before this board.
So could I correctly deduce from your comment, Supervisor, that you are speaking in opposition to the resolution?
Let me think on it. Yes.
Okay. Discussion. Supervisor Marzo, with all due respect, you've spoken once. I will come back to you if no one else wishes to speak. Supervisor Malik.
I'd like to speak. I like this, the wording of this question, and it's its explanation prepared by the Office of the Corporation Counsel better than the question we had several years ago. And I don't know just who to credit, but I'll credit anybody. And the reason I like it better is because it points out how much levy support is in the 2012 budget for the nursing home. So that, as I read this, if the voters say no, that they don't want to support the nursing home with partial levy funding, that'll be some guidance to the next board. But if they say yes, it will be implicit that they want support up to the amount of the 2012 levy support, $333,000. That's not the kind of guidance that the board got from the last referendum question. And so I think this is a very significant improvement. Now, whether, you know, in the future we can find levy support of $333,000 every year till we get to 2015, which is apparently the target for cutting off all levy support, it may be difficult. It may result in layoffs in other parts of the county's operation if that be the case. But at least there will be that guidance coming forward if the referendum gets on the ballot and it is supported by the citizens. So to that extent, I'm in favor of this referendum question.
I'm a bit confused. You're in favor of the referendum question if it gets on the ballot, but for purposes of voting today, are you in favor or opposed to the question?
I think this is a much better question than the last one.
Sir, are you an attorney?
And proud of it.
Supervisor Horn.
Thank you, Board Chair. I am going to speak in favor of the resolution. I think it's a simple question. My constituents know that I have supported and continue to support the nursing home in New Richmond, and I think at the same time that I am asking them to vote for me to essentially return me to this board at the next term, it gives them the opportunity to, if they feel different than my opinion, they can speak to that. And so that's why I think at the April election would be a good time to have this referendum. Thank you.
Again, Supervisor Nortenbaum and Supervisor Marzoff, you have both spoken. I will come back to both of you, but those of you that have not expressed any position or and made any comment, do you wish to do that? Supervisor Peavy.
Yes, I would like to echo Supervisor Nortenbaum's comments. I think a binding referendum would be more appropriate. It would make it simpler for supervisors to vote in the future, and with the possible number of changes in this board in April, the same question could be asked as we have in the past. So I would speak against this resolution today and be in favor of making a binding resolution, binding referendum in the future. Thank you.
Supervisor Scheer.
I'm going to echo that. I agree with that 110%. That we put this off for the new board that comes on as a binding referendum to do this at this point is just going to continue to murky, cloudy waters even more. So I speak against voting for this.
Anyone that has not spoken before I return to supervisors that already have? In the order then that you requested to speak, I'll come back to Supervisor Marzoff.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Supervisor Malik, I would just like to comment on your comment by adding an additional remark. In the language of the referendum question on page 2, I would just like to point out that in the middle line of the second paragraph, the $333,002 is, I'm going to need some help here, but I believe it's less than half, of what was used in 2011. So that's my comment.
Supervisor Nortonbaum.
Thank you, Board Chair. I'm going to make an amendment to this resolution, if I may.
And I'd like motion to amend is in order.
I'll give you the lines in which I'd like the amendment. In line 8, whereas the future of the St. Croix County Health Center, I want it to say in New Richmond. Line 14, St. Croix County Nursing Home, in New Richmond. Line 36, St. Croix County Nursing Home, in New Richmond. Line 41, St. Croix County Nursing Home, in New Richmond. Line 52, St. Croix County Nursing Home, in New Richmond. Line 57, St. Croix County Nursing Home, in New Richmond. Line 63, County Nursing Home, in New Richmond. Well, yeah, that's fine. County Nursing Home in New Richmond.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Line 67, St. Croix County Nursing Home in New Richmond. And line 72, St. Croix County Nursing Home in New Richmond.
Is there a second? We have an amendment from Supervisor Nortonbaum, second by Supervisor Sather. For the insertion of language, the language is in New Richmond in the lines that she just identified. If I could summarize that in the most simple format, I believe every place that we have identified the St. Croix County Nursing Home, you have also added in New Richmond. That's the intent of your amendment?
Yes, the intent of my amendment, yes. Yes.
A motion is made and seconded. This is a motion to amend the resolution that's in front of us. Discussion on the amendment. Supervisor Malik.
I think there were two places where it was omitted. One is at line 24.
And Supervisor, that's why I specifically 24. Said in summary, every place that we've identified the St. Croix County Nursing Home, the addition would be in New Richmond.
And the other is line 56.
That's why you pay us lawyers.
Thank you. Thank you.
By the word.
Thank you.
Any additional discussion or comment on the amendment? If not, we'll proceed to vote on the amendment. We have a second by Supervisor Sather, is that in? On a motion to amend from Supervisor Nortonbaum, with a second by Supervisor Sather, the amendment would be the insertion of the language in New Richmond following every identification in this resolution of the St. Croix County Nursing Home. So in every case it would read St. Croix County Nursing Home in New Richmond. Proceed to vote. And that passes unanimously. And now we're back to an amended resolution. Supervisor Marzoff.
I don't mean to nitpick, but on line 24, because it doesn't say nursing home, it says nursing homes. That needs to be fixed up a little bit to include the word New Richmond. Perhaps you could say, whereas the
Supervisor,
The budget of the St. Croix County Nursing Home in New Richmond, maybe we could do it that way for 212.
I think that's a given. Yeah, I understand your point. I don't think an amendment is in order that would be done. Okay. We have an amended resolution in front of us. Discussion on the amended resolution, which would be to approve or deny a referendum question relating to the county nursing home in New Richmond. Additional comments or discussion? Seeing none, I think we're prepared to vote. This originally came to us on a motion by Supervisor Wentz, with a second by Supervisor Schrank. Supervisors, this will be a resolution approving an advisory referendum question relating to the St. Croix County Nursing Home in New Richmond. Proceed to vote. The resolution is approved. Do you have any reports of any correspondence or rezoning requests?
I have one rezoning request from Kirk Hexum in the town of Star Prairie to rezone approximately 1 acre from ag res to commercial. And then I'm in need of the sign-in sheet from the meeting today. That's all I have.
Elfie, do you have that sign-in sheet back? Have you got it? Turn that in. One announcement to be made, and in his report, Administrator Thompson did indicate that we are looking at a tentative date for a meeting of the Committee of the Whole. Right now, the date that we're looking at is Thursday, 26 January. So tentatively get that on your calendar. Immediately following this meeting, we will have a very brief meeting of the Administration Committee, and I have asked chairs of Public Protection and Community Development to also sit in on that meeting briefly, and we'll be looking at agenda items for inclusion on that agenda. So right now, mark your calendars, at least on a tentative basis, for Thursday, 26 January. And I have nothing else to come before us. And supervisors, with that, we have completed our agenda, and we are adjourned.